ओके स्टूडेंट्स, दिस इज शॉर्ट वीडियो, अ वेरी शॉर्ट वीडियो ऑन द टॉपिक्स ऑन विच वी हैड आस्क्ड क्वेश्चंस ऑन डे वन. सो अ शॉर्ट वीडियो ऑन क्वेश्चंस ऑफ डे वन. सो आई थिंक यू कैन सी माय स्क्रीन. देयर वर टू क्वेश्चंस दैट वर आस्क्ड. द फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन वाज व्हाट बायोलॉजिकल चेंजेस मेड ह्यूमन बीइंग्स केपेबल ऑफ मेकिंग कल्चर, एंड 20 मार्क्स. And mosaic evolution 10 marks. Okay, so what biological changes made man being beings human beings capable of making culture? This is something that we discussed multiple times, or discussed elaborate detail in our two classes that we have had. So I will not go too much into detail of this. I will discuss this a little later. First, let me talk about mosaic evolution. Mosaic evolution. Everyone who has submitted the answer, all of you have written the correct answer. But do we all understand the concept clearly? So let's just try to understand the concept of mosaic evolution. Just one second. Okay, so mosaic. What comes to our mind when we see, you know, the word mosaic? You know, marble mosaic, like, you know, this on the marble floor, you know, you have different marbles, separate marble. This marble is separate from this marble. This marble is separate from this marble. This is a mosaic of marbles. So they're separate. They are separate. You know, this marble is not part of this. This is not part of this. They're all separate. You know, they have their own separate existence. Another term for mosaic evolution is modular evolution. So you must have seen the ads of, or, you know, if you have a modular kitchen in your house, you must be aware of modular kitchen. So, you know, there are different sections in the modular kitchen. You know, I open this section, you know, I can pull up the spoon and stuff. I close it. I open the other section. I can take out the plates, I close it. Another section, the cups on the top, I can open and take out the spices and everything. So different sections, you know, it's not as if I'm pulling up, everything is opening up. Small, 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 small sections, which are independently moving from the other. So one section is moving independently from the other. If I'm pulling up this section, the other one is not opening. Now I can close this and at the same time open this one. So they are, you know, moving independent of each other. They are not attached to the other. Modular kitchen. So similar concept in evolution, mosaic or modular evolution. We'll discuss this with a couple of examples and a small, nice story. You know, first the story part. So around 1920s, 30s, there was a scholar, you know, named Raymond Dart. He was a professor in some university in South Africa, you know. So if this is Africa, somewhere here, you know, or maybe even further south. Just give me one moment, guys. Just one second. Yeah, I hope you can hear me again. Okay. So, yeah. So, this is, you know, South Africa, somewhere here, a place called Tong. T-A-U-N-G, Tong. So, this person was there, you know, and he did not find it. Some laborers working in, you know, at a work site, they found a small skull kind of thing, and they brought it to Mr. Dart. They knew that this guy is a scholar. He studies ancient bones and ancient findings. So he spent a lot of time. So Raymond Dart was very excited, you know, looking at this piece of fossil. And he found out that it was a skull, a very small skull, totally fossilized, lot of concrete and rock and soil has had gotten attached to it, and the fossilized bone and the rocks could not be separated. But so he got dedicated in clearing it. Every day, a few hours, he used to sit and clear it so that he can separate the fossil from the rest of the rocks. A very difficult task. He did not want to break the fossil. He dedicated so much time and effort into it that his wife got angry, and this used to get angry that this guy doesn't go out in parties and all with me, and he's not enjoying his life with me, not going to the movies and all, and he's just sitting with that piece of bone. But still, this Mr. Dart was very dedicatedly working on it, and he was able to separate it, and he was amazed to hold it in his hand and see the small tiny fossil. It was a child, it was a baby Australopithecus. So Australopithecus, in Australopithecus, this word austral, it means south. Austral means south. Okay, Australia, the southern land. You have Aurora Borealis, the phenomenon in the sky, in the northern pole, and Aurora Australis in southern, near South Pole. So Austral means south. So in southern part, South Africa, it was found. So Australopithecus. This was a child of a baby Australopithecus. It was called the Tong child. It was found in Tong, so Tong child. He was holding the skull of a, he later said that it was around 3 year old. 3 year old Australopithecus baby who had died, maybe killed by a big, a bird of prey, because the fossil, along with the skull, some eggs were also fossilized, and those eggs belonged to a big, bird of prey. So possibly this baby was picked up by a big, bird of prey, taken to its nest and killed there and eaten there, and maybe the skull got fossilized with some egg cells of that bird. So this is a theory that he gave. Yeah, so 3 year old. Now, why I'm discussing all this? What happened in this story is that, combining with several other fossil finds around that area of Australopithecus, Raymond Dart gave the theory that this Tong child is a human ancestor. This Tong child is an ancestor of humans because, it had bipedalism. So it could walk on two legs. So human ancestor. But this theory was outrightly rejected by other scholars at that time. They said that this is not a human ancestor at all. This is simply an ancestor of a chimpanzee or a gorilla. It's an ape. It's an ancestor of one of the modern apes, maybe chimpanzee, gorilla, orangutan, something, but not man. Why? Because it is not, according to those scholars, those who rejected the theory, they said that it's not possible that bipedalism had developed without a big brain. So what they meant was that, human evolution, what are the main features of human evolution? So hand, feet, and all those things are there. But two main features, bipedalism, walking on two legs, and a bigger brain compared to other, our ancestors and, other relatives like, chimpanzee and all. So big brain and bipedalism. So the theory by around that time was that these were developing together. So if a fossil has a bigger brain, it's all, it is bipedal, it also has to got big brain, otherwise it's not human, because in human means both big brain as well as bipedalism, both has to be there. Okay, so this Tong child's, yeah, it was a child, but still, even for a human child, the skull was too small, the brain was too small. So it was said it cannot be a human, even though if it is bipedal, it cannot be human because the brain is too small, So it, Raymond Dart's theory was rejected. And, so this quest for missing link between man and the man's ancestors went on, and someone took advantage of that. So this conception that bipedalism and big brain development should go hand in hand, should go together, not, something happening first, something happening later, not like that, should go together, hand in hand. This, theory was utilized or misused to the advantage of one person. His name was Charles Dawson. So what Mr. Dawson did चार्ल्स डॉसन। ही थॉट दैट एवरी ऑल द स्कॉलर्स आर लुकिंग फॉर अ मिसिंग लिंक, सो समथिंग दैट शुड हैव फीचर्स ऑफ बिटवीन मैन एंड एप, फीचर्स फीचर्स बिटवीन मैन एंड एप दैट विल बी आवर मिसिंग लिंक, सो ही शुड हैव काइंड ऑफ ह्यूमन क्वालिटीज ऑल्सो, अ लॉट ऑफ ह्यूमन क्वालिटीज, सो द टीथ एंड द जॉ एंड द ब्रेन शुड बी बिग, और एटलीस्ट द टीथ एंड जॉ शुड बी मोर लाइक अ मैन, टीथ एंड जॉ, इफ समथिंग ही फाइंड्स अ टीथ एंड जॉ दैट इज लाइक मैन, ही कैन से दैट इट इज अ मिसिंग लिंक। वॉट ही डिड वॉज ही took a chimpanzee bone, he took a chimpanzee bone that was a chimpanzee that had died a few years ago, he took the teeth and the jaw of a chimpanzee, he rubbed it because the chimpanzee teeth will have big canines and bigger teeth, and while the man has more shapely small teeth, so he rubbed it, rubbed the teeth, the canine enamel of a chimpanzee to make it similar to a human, and he buried it in a pit, he buried it somewhere, and later he acted as if he has found out some fossils with which teeth like man, and he says that he has found the missing link fossil, and he also got credit for that, and so this concept that jaw, teeth, brain and bipedalism all were developing at the same rate at the same time, this was this because of this concept Raymond Dart did not get the credit of finding the human ancestor Australopithecus. It was realized many many years later that Raymond Dart was right, that was a human ancestor, and Charles Dawson was able to take advantage, and it was again realized many many years later that Charles Dawson was a fraud, and this thing is called Piltdown hoax. This thing done by Charles Dawson is called Piltdown hoax. So all this happened because of the misconception that everything is developing at the same rate, brain, bipedalism, teeth and jaw all are developing at the same rate, so an ape will have everything very primitive and a man will have everything very advanced, and anything in between will be a missing link, and it is a straight line from ape to man, which may middle there is a missing link, but there is this thing doesn't happen. Mosaic evolution, the theory is we realized later that not everything developed at the same pace, so in our human evolution our bipedalism, walking on two feet, developed much earlier than having a bigger brain, so Australopithecus they had become bipedal, but there was brain was nothing big compared to a chimpanzee today, they had no developed brain but they became bipedal. Later the brain developed, okay? So Australopithecus is one example of mosaic evolution. Mosaic, independent rate of development, brain developing at its own independent pace, not attached to bipedalism, not having at the same pace at the same time at the same rate like bipedalism developing first because of the evolutionary pressures, we know that they had come down from the Australopithecus had to come down from the trees, and the tall grasses had to look over the tall grasses, had to run quickly to reach the other tree to eat the fruit, we had discussed all this, so this evolutionary pressure of survival made bipedalism develop faster and earlier, and later because of bipedalism walking on two feet he could go and survey a longer so when I'm like walking on four legs I cannot see very further, I can just see my area of vision is very limited, but when I stand on 2 feet my area of vision is 360 degrees, I can see up, I can see down, I can see forward everywhere, lot of vision, lot of thing being soaked in, lot of new information being processed by the brain, so brain development, and hands freed, so something doing something with the hand again stress on the brain and brain is developing, so bipedalism developed first and later brain got enlarged, and one of the factors for brain being developed was that bipedalism had already developed, and the things that we were doing because of becoming bipedal they were putting pressure on our brain, and our brain was developing. So brain developed after bipedalism. So this explains why Australopithecus, the tongue child, you know, was bipedal, but the brain was very small compared to man. So had, you know, the people at that time, you know, if the scholars then had the concept of mosaic evolution, Raymond Dart would have got his, you know, credit on time and not rejected at that point of time. So he was rejected because people did not know mosaic evolution back then. They thought everything evolves at the same time. So Australopithecus, especially tongue child, an example where bipedalism had developed, but brain much smaller. Okay. Another example, Homo erectus. When you read about Homo erectus, one of the lines you may read in the books is that Homo erectus was fully developed, totally like a modern man, below the neck. Below the neck, the shoulders, the arms, the legs, you know, body hair, all body hair lost, you know, like today's man, very few body hair, totally bipedal, totally erect, and feet with nice, you know, like today's, you know, man, big toe is not opposable, and arch and heel. So heel and there is an arch, all these things that help in, you know, effective locomotion. Those things are already developed by then very nicely. So totally modern below the neck. Above the neck, it was very primitive, almost like a chimpanzee. So the only part of Homo erectus that was still primitive was above the neck, the skull and the head. It was still, you know, big brow ridges, you know, big brow ridges and not much bigger brain. And still the mouth had, you know, a lot of prognathism coming out, snout, okay. Still the jaw very heavy, still big teeth, you know, canine and diastema and all those things still there. And the brain not very big. So his, you know, skull was still very much primitive, brain still primitive, but below the neck, totally modern. So again, this shows, you know, modularity or modular evolution or mosaic evolution, that all features not developing at the same time, you know, back and forth. What happens is sometimes, suppose, you know, and you know, even this would not have happened, that, you know, just entire bipedalism developed and then bipedalism stopped and then brain started developing. Not like that. Maybe they have overlapped. Maybe, you know, bipedalism developing for a longer period of time and then brain developing for some time and then stopping, again bipedalism, and then again brain developing for some time and stopping. So stopping, starting, stopping, starting, stopping, restarting, becoming faster then slower, faster then slower, driven by the environment around us, you know, driven by the environment around us, whether right now a lot of, you know, stress is falling on the brain, whether the ancestor is having to use a lot of brain or a lot of hands or a lot of feet, whatever, depending on the surroundings, on the, you know, environmental factors, different parts developed at different pace, and this is mosaic evolution. So we saw the example of Australopithecus, brain still back, you know, primitive, but bipedalism had developed before brain. Homo erectus, again below the neck, fully modern, but above the neck quite primitive. And then the story of tongue child of Raymond Dart, as well as, you know, Piltdown hoax of Charles Dawson. So, you know, these are some of the things that you can add in your answers as you know, your examples and stuff that will make your answer very good. But remember, 10 marks. It's a 10 marker. If it is a 10 marker, you have to limit all these things and do not, you know, make it too good an answer or too perfect an answer. I saw some answers where the diagrams were better than the book's diagrams. If you are able to draw those diagrams within 7-8 minutes of answer writing, means answer writing and diagram within, say, 7-8-10 minutes, fine. If you are writing for 7 minutes and then drawing a diagram for 10 minutes, no. Stop it. Don't do that. Try to simplify your diagram. You don't need to make exact book-like diagrams. Try to develop some simplified diagrams. And, you know, suppose if you are drawing a diagram and putting it inside a box. So I have, sorry. Yeah. So something went wrong. So I have, suppose, you know, made a diagram. I put it inside a box. These lines that I'm making, you don't need to take a scale and a pencil to make those lines. You can simply draw these lines with your hands around the diagram, you know. So coloring, yes, it's very good if you have used color pencil, but then the full coloring is not required, or the full diagram should not be shaded and colored. Those things, that artistic things, you can, you know, do away with. What you can do is you can use color pencils, you know, only where, you know, using things of different colors will help you. For example, you know, for the competitive exclusion, you know, or Gauss's rule, when you are, some people have drawn this tree and the birds there, you know, a bird shown in the red color, a smaller bird, and then later a bigger bird coming, you know, and a bigger bird coming that is blue color. So to show that there are two different types of birds, you can use color here. But again, the shading thing on all those things are not required. Simply the outlines you can show, you know, that this is a bigger bird that comes later, and then there is a competition on all those things. Okay, so these are some tips for the second answer. For the first answer, what biological changes made humans capable of making culture? So integration, the biology part we had discussed in the class very nicely. So almost all of you have written that. Very good. I would not go again into, you know, all the changes that happened, you know, because we have discussed multiple times the spinal cord and the foramen magnum, the brain, the snout, the head, the tongue, and all those things. What I want to add to your answers is, you know, when you're starting that answer, the question says, what biological changes enabled man to make culture? This is a question of physical anthropology or biological anthropology. So you are, you know, limiting yourself to writing only biological stuff, starting with, okay, so these are the changes in the man and blah, blah, blah. It's anthropology. Anthropology is a bio-cultural subject. Don't miss out the culture part if you can in that answer. So you can begin the answer by defining culture. Yes, question asks, what enabled man to make culture? So let's start defining what is culture. You can start with culture, you know, definition. You know, as per Herskovitz, man and his works, or a definition, you know, that says that culture is the man-made part of the environment. These are two simple, you know, definitions. Or you can give the more elaborate definition of E.B. Tyler. According to E.B. Tyler in his book, Primitive Cultures, 1871, he has defined culture as that complex whole that includes knowledge, belief, arts, morals, laws, and customs, and any other learned behavior or any other behavior that man has acquired as part of the society. This is a fantastic, beautiful, very complex and comprehensive, very comprehensive definition of culture. So you can begin your answer with this definition of Tyler of culture, you know, and then you can say that, you know, so culture is all, you know, those man-made things, you know, whether it is knowledge, belief, you know, arts, morals, laws, customs, which are intangible, or tangible things, you know, like houses, clothing, stone tools, you know, all those things. So these tangible, intangible things man has made, that is culture. How man has made it? Because of the following biological changes. And then you give the biological changes, that opposable hand, you know, ability to make tools and all those things, you know, and you know, the big brain, Wernicke's area, and angular gyrus, and you know, so ability to speak, and all those things, you know. So integrate the culture part also. Give the culture's definition by Tyler. Wherever you get an opportunity to define something and give a scholar's name and give a book's name, do not miss it out. So begin with what is culture, and then go ahead with the biological changes that enabled man to make culture. Give a nice conclusion also, like, you know, you can think of a conclusion that had these biological changes not taken place, you know, we would not have been where we are today. You know, the man being the most dominant species on this planet, we would not have gained that dominant position. We have been able to gain that dominant position because of things called culture, the things that we have made ourselves, the guns and that whatever, the tools and stuff. So that dominant position could not have been gained had there not been these biological changes. So that kind of a conclusion. So that was the, you know, a short video regarding the questions of day one. And soon I will be making a video also for the questions of day 2, 3 and so on. And in some time I'll be sharing the questions for day 4. Okay. And don't worry, your answers will be checked in around 72 hours, so around 3 days. Max to max 3 to 4 days, not more than that. If the number of copies increase, then it will be a little hectic, but I'll still try to check as early as possible and give you feedbacks. I'm giving the feedbacks individually on the chats so that you know, maintaining your privacy and all. And one more thing, so that will be it. And soon we'll also have a video on the time management thing in the answer writing, you know, time management versus quality, whether time management and quality are antagonistic, whether you know, whether if you improve quality, your time will be crunch, you know, you'll have short time, or if you manage time, your quality will be poor. Whether this is true, whether it is quality versus content or content versus time management, we'll look into that in a separate video. Okay, so that will be all, guys. Thank you. Have a nice day.